Protocol at ChainSafe Systems, thank you. I'm also one of the co-organizers of East Berlin, and I used to work on various EF and ESP grants in the past for both execution layer and consensus layer clients. And among others, as Francie already mentioned, I launched the Goerli testnet with a bunch of cool people that are also sitting here in the room in 2019. So what I'm going to cover today is I want to briefly dive into the Ethereum protocol history prior to the merge. And then specifically take a close look at the implications of the merge on the testnets, and finally give a quick guide to selecting a testnet for your project. So yeah, let's dive right into the protocol history. Everything started with a testnet. Does anyone here know what's the meaning of the Ethereum Genesis extra data is? You might know the Bitcoin extra data Genesis extra data contains a news headline. Does anyone know what the meaning of the Ethereum extra data is? It's actually a block hash from a testnet. Ethereum was publicly fairly launched by announcing a block number on an Olympic testnet that was 1,028,201. And once this testnet was mined on the testnet, this hash could be inserted into the Ethereum Genesis and the public mining on Ethereum mainnet could start. Olympic was the last pre-release testnet before the Ethereum mainnet was launched, and the first public Ethereum testnet after the launch was Morden. Morden was a proof-of-work testnet using the same ETH-hash algorithm as mainnet, and interestingly, it had a custom starting nonce of 2 to the power of 20 to prevent transaction replays on mainnet. Most of us probably remember the Shanghai attacks during Devcon 2 in 2016. An attacker exploited the long disk read time of the Xcode size opcode in one of the client implementations, which caused the denial of service of the Ethereum mainnet. Here's a photo of the amazing guest team investigating the issues and coming up with a solution. To address this issue, two subsequent hard forks were scheduled for Ethereum. The Tangerine Whistle fork to fix the attack vector, and the Spurious Dragon fork to allow cleaning up the state afterwards. However, this protocol change caused a consensus failure on Morden. This was specifically caused by the different ways how the clients handled this custom starting nonce. And it was then decided it's not a good idea to have a custom protocol on a testnet, and therefore Morden was discontinued and replaced by a new testnet called Ropsten. Ropsten was the first testnet to launch with chain ID right from Genesis. The chain ID served the purpose of simple replay protection according to EIP 155. So the Ropsten testnet was also powered by the ETH proof of work engine. We all know proof of work is fairly permissionless. So there is no good incentive to secure a zero-value proof-of-work testnet. So attackers moved to DOS, Ropsten, and the testnet was unusable for weeks. In response, Parity launched the Kovan proof-of-authority testnet, and guests launched the Rinkeby proof-of-authority testnet. For the first time, Ethereum had a way to have a more stable testnet environment. However, Kovan used the Parity Aura consensus engine, and Rinkeby used the guest click consensus engine, and they were not compatible. Kovan was therefore only accessible through the Parity Ethereum stack, whereas Rinkeby was only accessible by guests or tooling that relied on the guest stack. So in 2018, the Goerli initiative attempted to address this by ideating a cross-client proof-of-authority testnet. In the end, the initiative managed to implement click and parity, and subsequently in 2019, the Goerli testnet was launched as a first cross-client proof-of-authority testnet with validators from both GES and Parity Ethereum. At the same time, coincidentally, after DEFCON in Prague, I believe, the Pantheon client was released, so there was even a third client available for running validators on this testnet, and soon after also Nethermind joined the validator set. Yeah, later this same year, Parity exits Ethereum and leaving Kovan fairly unmaintained, unfortunately. Now, going fast forward in time, just earlier this year, to prepare for the merge, some of the older testnets had to be deprecated. The protocol support team announced the end of life for Ropsten and Rinkeby on the amazing Ethereum Foundation block. They argued the older testnets are harder to maintain due to growing history and state and the growing complexity to run the testnet setup. So in foresight, however, a new testnet was launched, Sepolia. Interestingly, Sepolia, that was just launched not even a year ago, it was launched as a proof of work testnet using the same eSash algorithm as mainnet back in the day. It was the first time since the Ropsten launch in 2017 that we actually launched a new proof of work testnet. The reason was potentially to have another testnet similar to mainnet to allow for, once again, testing the merge under mainnet conditions. Okay, so let's recap the testnets prior to the merge. Morden is fairly dead. It was replaced by Ropsten in 2017. Ropsten, then again, was just deprecated a couple of weeks ago. Kovan died with Parity leaving Ethereum. Rinkeby was also deprecated just a couple of months ago, and that leaves us with Goerli and Sepolia as the latest testnets for Ethereum. And now let's just take a look at what it actually means to merge. Yeah, I took a lot of time to build these slides. So in Ethereum, this, the merge stands for an event where two blockchains are literally glued together. You need a consensus layer beacon chain that takes over finality and fork choice considerations, here shown in blue. And this consensus layer beacon chain replaces the legacy proof of work consensus or yeah, other consensus mechanisms on the execution layer here depicted in red. So this slide shows the timeline of the testnet merges. And I added a lot of details here. I'm standing in front of it. I added a lot of details here, but let's revisit this slide in a bit after talking a bit about the implications. So just to recap, a proof of work consensus mechanism is permissionless as per Nakamoto consensus. So you can just turn on your CPU miner and hope for a block in theory. On the other hand, a proof of authority is permissioned. Obviously, only authorized accounts may take part in consensus. And then again, proof of stake is fairly permissionless. You have a token and you can stake it to take part in consensus. So what does it mean for Ethereum mainnet? The merge, obviously, moving from proof of work to proof of stake just does not change much in this perspective. It was permissionless before the merge. It is still permissionless after the merge. But how does it look like for the testnets? So Goerli was merged with the Prata beacon chain testnet. And to access, to get access to the consensus on the Goerli testnet prior to the merge was permissioned. So Goerli was running a community-maintained validator set. However, after the merge, it transitioned to a proof-of-stake consensus, interestingly, and suddenly everyone can participate in consensus, given you have access to Goerli Ether. So Goerli used to be permissioned, is now permissionless. But what about Sepolia? As I mentioned, prior to the merge, it was powered by the permissionless eSash proof-of-work algorithm. Here you can see my Sepolia miner. I was happy that I once again can mine a testnet. And yeah, I did not ask for permission. I can just I was just able to mine the blocks. I got a lot of Sepolia Ether. But now there's something unique about the Sepolia beacon chain. Since it was apparent that Goerli will no longer be permissioned, there was actually the quest for having another permissioned testnet to have certain stability guarantees. So it was decided that Sepolia gets a beacon chain with a modified deposit contract that does not accept regular Ether deposits. Instead, it tracks the validator set through an ERC20 token. So in that case, Sepolia is a proof of authority version of the beacon chain, and therefore the access to Sepolia consensus is permissioned. So let's take a look at this overview again. This is a timeline actually on the x-axis. The first testnet to merge was Ropsten. Ropsten was fairly similar to mainnet. It was proof of work. And after the merge, it was proof of stake, right? So permissionless, permissionless. Then Sepolia transitioned with this modified beacon chain. So technically, the consensus algorithm is still proof of stake, but through this permissioned ERC20 token that you require to take part in consensus, I call it, for simplicity, proof of authority here, because the access to this consensus is actually permissioned. And then Goerli merged with Prata and testnet, where exactly the opposite happened. The proof of authority Goerli testnet became a proof of stake Goerli testnet after the merge. And then, yeah, we are here. Eventually, just a couple of weeks ago, the mainnet merge occurred. So, yeah, just take a look at the post merge testnet landscape. I showed you that Ropsten merged. However, it has been deprecated by the Ethereum Foundation's protocol support team. And it leaves us with Goerli and Sepolia as the only long-standing public post-merge testnets. So I will conclude my presentation with a testnet selection guide. I mean, it's only two testnets. How hard can it be? I mentioned how amazing the Ethereum block is. It's just a great resource. I found this slide on the Ethereum blog. Basically just recaps what I just said. The open validator set for Goerli on the one hand, the closed validator set for Sepolia on the other hand. Obviously, since Goerli is much older, it has a large state. That gives some better network effect. So if you have an application that you want to deploy on Goerli and you require other applications or interfaces, you might find them on Sepolia, on Goerli, but not on Sepolia, because Sepolia is fairly new and not many applications and libraries are deployed yet. However, it's also longer to sync and more involved to run Goerli infrastructure. So to summarize this, please do use Goerli testnet as it is most similar to the Ethereum mainnet. Goerli is especially interesting for you if you plan to test a beacon chain validator, if you want to test your setup, if you want to test upgrading client versions, if you want to test going through protocol upgrades. Goerli is potentially the best, or if not even the only testnet where you can actually conduct this. Yes, please also do use the Sepolia testnet. Sepolia comes with the best stability guarantees due to the permissioned validator set. Since it's fairly new, it is fastest to sync and also it has the best long-term guarantees. So I would lean towards recommending to test your applications or even migrate your applications to Sepolia instead of Goerli at this point. Yeah, do not use Ropsten, obviously. When I prepared my slides, I realized that we are just in this transition phase where big service providers already start shutting down infrastructure, so you have to expect interruptions and downtime. Don't use Kovan for obvious reasons. And yes, also I would not recommend using Rinkeby, even though there is some long-term support planned for Rinkeby for almost another year, but you will potentially not get more protocol upgrades on that network, so I would also not recommend using Rinkeby in that regard. Yeah, right. There are some caveats, though. As I mentioned, the Goerli testnet has Ether supply issues due to the sheer amount of users trying to test their validator setup. Each validator requires 32 ETH, and if you want to have a more involved setup with, I don't know, 1,000 validators, it quickly becomes a huge burden, huge problem to access these required testnet tokens. This is something we still need to figure out going forward, so if you have an idea, please hit me up. Yeah, and in terms of testnet age, Goerli is also fairly old, so it comes with a fairly big, a rich history and state, and is therefore more difficult to synchronize, especially now that it's merged with Prata, which also comes with a fairly old beacon chain in combination. And yeah, Sepolia is relatively new, as I mentioned. I wrote down lack of infrastructure. I put it in brackets because it's changing really rapidly right now. I just noticed while preparing my slides that even MetaMask has a Sepolia testnet switch now, so it's happening. I'm really happy that we get all these integrations now. But yeah. Okay, this is my subjective recommendation. If you want to test infrastructure, if you want to test your validators, I would recommend you to run them on Goerli. If you want to test your applications, I would even encourage you to skip Goerli and go straight to run your stack on Sepolia. Okay, this was my talk. Please use Goerli or Sepolia going forward. Find me for some spare Ether cards from East Berlin. They are preloaded with Goerli and Sepolia Ether, so if you want some, I will not throw them into the audience, but just find me after the talk. And yes, yeah, since we have a couple of minutes left, please ask questions.
Thanks for the presentation. Is there any tutorial or manual how to be a validator in Sepolia? How to be, to help in the infrastructure?
Short answer is you can't. Because, as I mentioned, even though it's proof of stake, you need a special ERC20 token to get access to this validator set, and you would basically have to Google Sepolia GitHub repository, and there is an issue where you can request to be added to this validator set, but in general, not many teams will be accepted, just to keep it really small, the validator set.
Maybe two questions here. One, when EIP-1559 came around, it was very hard to test that in advance because you'd have these proof of authority networks that had no fee market, and then you have these proof of work networks that had like kind of a fee market. You could kind of reason about sort of what that change would do. Sorry, I am leading into a question here. I'm just giving some background. And then Kovan, if I seem to remember right, was like Parity Technologies maintained it for the old Open Ethereum Parity client, sort of the idea. And I think like now the execution layer is a spec. There's some value behind, testing clients. So I guess just to sum it up to a question, both testing features and execution layer specs, has there any thought been behind testing those kind of things moving forward, spinning up testnets or forks of testnets to do that? So.
I'm sorry, I don't think I got the question. It's also, I don't have the speakers. If you could just try to speak up a bit.
Testing specific features of Ethereum forks, like a fee market changes, or testing or validating the execution spec was sort of the goal. Because like you had Open Ethereum or Parity and Geth, and whether they synced up or not in terms of whether they're executing EVM basically correctly was always a question, right? If they ever split, so that's what I'm asking is like where is the testnet infrastructure sort of going in terms of forks and things? They're just gonna spin it up whenever or whatever. I don't want to beat this to death.
I hope I understand the question correctly. So I was talking about public testnets today, and public testnets is always a really final stage of testing everything. So if you want to test execution layer changes, consensus layer changes, and whatnot, you usually go from like local simulations to permissioned devnets to through like a lot of hurdles until you actually get to a public testnet. And these testnets, like when I recommend Goerli or Sepolia, they will only get protocol upgrades that have been sufficiently tested before. I don't know if this answers your question. Okay.
Hi, Afri.
Whoa, Bob. That's loud. Do you know why did the mergers happen the way round they did? Wouldn't it have been more logical for Goerli to continue as a proof of authority?
Sorry, I think I have to come down. I just need to be...
I'm just wondering why the mergers happened the way round that they did, as opposed to Goerli continuing as a proof of authority and Sepolia transitioning.
Yeah, thank you. That's a very good question. The reason is that it merged with the Prada testnet, which used to be a consensus layer testnet for a very long time, where many teams already tested running validators for more than a year or 1.5 years. So it was already this proof of stake testnet available, and it was decided not to launch a new testnet, beacon chain testnet for Goerli specifically, and just use the existing one. So that's why we had this flip. It was also discussed to maybe have a new deposit contract on Goerli, but in the end they decided it's actually worse for testing the merge to do the big merge. Because Prata was also the only consensus layer testnet that had about approximately the same amount of validators in mainnet, as mainnet.
So like long history for them both?
Yes. And it was very, very valuable for specifically the consensus layer teams to have to not sunset this Prada testnet, and you cannot move this Prada testnet to another execution layer because it's all linked to the deposit contract.
Have validators or the external participants on these testnets, and you need to do a bug fix. When you need to do a bug fix on the testnet code, are the external participants, such as validators, having to rebuild their validators on a new machine image or a new version of the code base? And how often does that happen during the testnet phases?
What's the question? If there's a bug fix on a testnet, how often do you have to rebuild your clients?
Yeah, what's the workflow when there is bug fixes applied to the testnets? If you are a validator, there might be a protocol bug. So does the validators get coordinated and they redeploy their nodes multiple times during the testnet rollout?
Yes, this is basically, the answer is yes, but this happens very rarely because most bugs are usually not caught on testnets. But much earlier. Thank you, everyone.